Shyam Sekhar, Chief Ideator and Founder of iThought, joins us right now on the show. Shyam, very good morning and thank you so much for joining us on Bloomberg Quint. This is Neeraj here. You know, we usually talk about investment strategies for the long term, and that is what we will eventually talk about. But I'm asking you to wear a tactical hat right now, Shyam. And even if you are a long-only investor, would you believe that there is maybe prudence in staying light ahead of what is turning out, arguably turning out to be an election that might go down the wire?
I have definitely lightened, so I can speak for myself. And it has nothing to do with the election alone. I think that overall, if you see the events that are unfolding, there'll be a lot of work to be done by the government in the coming months. So I think the markets have factored in all the good news, and I don't think any adverse news is factored into the markets as we speak.
Okay, so you are saying that irrespective of what happens in the election, which may have a short-term impact on the markets, you are staying light because you believe that there could be an ensuing correction because of various other factors.
Correct. That's my belief.
Okay. And would it essentially be linked to valuations alone, Shyam, your belief? Or are there other things that you believe that need to fall into place before the rally resumes?
If you look at how the markets have sustained at the current levels over the last month or two, it has been primarily driven by liquidity, not by sentiment. Okay. If you ask people whether they believe the economy is in great shape, you would probably get a iffy answer. But they would still say that they would buy, and they would also reiterate that they would not sell now. So there are two variables to the way the markets have behaved in recent times. One is people did not want to sell, and they would buy because there was too much liquidity, right? So I think that even if one of these two variables changed, you could see a more saner approach return to the markets. And I think that is likely going forward.
By the way, the index has slipped into the red. I'm not surprised, really. I'm just mentioning it out. Look at the Nifty 50 losers as well. The index has slipped into the negative times, or rather negative lines. The Nifty Bank, 29 points off. The Sensex and the Nifty flat. So no alarm bells, bobbing between the red and the green, but the high start that the Nifty was indicating and that we got as well has come off completely in the session today. Okay, Shyam, now that brings me to my next question. Everybody tries to plan investing from an 18, 24, 36, maybe 48 month, maybe 60 month perspective in your case. I wouldn't presume here. But if indeed that's the kind of investment horizon that people should have, what should people do either now or if a correction comes about, as you are saying? Let's assume that there is status quo on almost all things or all concerns that we're talking about, and therefore there is a correction. I must add that a bunch of foreign voices that we're speaking to off late are saying that they prefer a clutch of other emerging markets which are cheaper compared to India, so that foreign money may not come back in a rush as well. And if indeed the domestic liquidity dries up even a little bit, I hope it doesn't, but even if a little bit, then the correction could be swift as well. So whether now or in a correction, what are areas that people should watch out for? Economy facing, export oriented, consumer facing, what are you doing personally?
See, there are two types of investments that I am looking at. One is businesses which will benefit from a cyclical turnaround, which is the top-down trade. So I would bet on companies where leverage is there, but they would come down and the company would be able to grow its valuation over a period of 3 to 4 years. In that, I think that there would be companies in sectors which will benefit, like infrastructure, but that's not an easy area to spot opportunities. So that is quite a struggle, but I'm still trying to do something there. The other area is in businesses which have very clean balance sheets, no debt, and reasonable growth. There, it is a struggle to find opportunities, but I still think there could be a few opportunities that one can spot going forward.
Is that your normal pattern of investment, Shyam? I mean, as a regular investor, there are some people who are cigar butt investors, some people who actually pay premium for growth. What is your regular style of investing, and are you changing that in the current scenario?
No, my risk appetite is limited, and I'm also an investor who reads and invests, not meets and invests. So when you read and invest, you're limited by not having perspectives which somebody who is a meet and invest investor has got. So therefore, I only have a competence to invest in businesses where I am able to read the present and future reasonably. So my area of investing, my domain is rather restricted. So I'm not able to bet in companies which are where you need to be constantly engaging with the management to be updated. So most of my investments are only these kind of investments where I can buy and hold and not really worry too much. Like, you know, if the results have come yesterday, I would have probably not seen the results for 4 days. I mean, I can only buy such businesses. I don't have a competence to, you know, have this 24/7 monitoring. On the other side, I like the top-down trade because there are a lot of structural stories where we can buy and hold. So that is where the commodities and some of these things come, where you are able to read certain trends. But that is only a small component of what I do, but I still enjoy that because yes, there is some excitement in buying such businesses and holding them through transformative change. This is broadly what I mean.
The reason I ask that, Shyam, is because I believe you've mentioned to us that 2018 asset allocation will need to be relooked into. What do you mean by that?
Yeah, I think that this trade from fixed deposits to balance funds is a ridiculous thing for an investor to do, and I think that is largely the fuel for 2017's equity exuberance. I believe that we have not guided people properly, and the policy has been slow to react. Given the opposition towards the changes in the FRDI bill also, I expect the government to correct this in the next budget through some changes which will not force a risk-averse investor to invest in equity. I think that asset allocation change will happen post-policy. And I'm expecting that we will see very decisive changes in the budget on this area. So those who have come to equity because fixed deposit returns went down, I think that trade will come to a halt in 2018. That's what I expect.
That wasn't a legislature which led people to do that, right, Shyam? Why is the opinion that it was the wrong trade to move out of fixed deposits into balanced funds?
See, most of the people who have moved from fixed deposit to balance fund don't even understand what risk they are taking. I'm asking a simple question. Let us say you have an inflationary spiral in 2018. Then the government, when it moves to battle inflation, will be forced to raise interest rates. I mean, RBI will be forced to raise interest rate, right? Then the original reason for people to shift away from fixed deposits to equity does not stand. The second thing is if the taxation on equity changes and long-term capital gains is brought on par with other asset classes, which I think the government seems to be moving towards, then again the reason for people who are risk-averse to invest in equity doesn't exist anymore. I think retirees putting all their FD money in equity is quite ridiculous, and I am quite concerned about this. But I don't see that concern among various market participants, but that is something that is definitely going to come to hurt, and that's why I'm saying that this asset allocation in 2018 for a lot of people will change. When I say a lot of people, I mean people who are usually those who rely only on fixed deposits for their livelihood.
Interesting thoughts, Shyam. Maybe someday we'll do a discussion with people who are on the other side of the trade as well. It'll be very interesting to do that. But last couple of questions really from my end. One is what's happening to themes? And I thought I would pick up two themes and talk to you about them. One is this whole data explosion theme, and we've seen that playing out very beautifully for a company called Sterlite Technologies. Do you presume that companies in this pocket, wherein a lot of people believe we are only scratched the tip of the iceberg, and the runway is fairly long, would stand to benefit over 3, 4, 5 years, irrespective of what happens in a particular quarter or two?
Definitely in businesses which are early stage businesses, one has to have a lot of patience to get returns, and one has to have a very sharp understanding of how the future will pan out, and that understanding should play out. You know, we should not be dreaming about what will happen, because in many cases, like in 2000, we thought that dot-coms were forever, but it didn't work that way. So we have to be careful in choosing companies which have revenue models which will grow into profitable, sustainable models. So that is something that we need to do. I don't have any view on the specific company that you mentioned, but these are early stage businesses. I know a lot of people who have invested in startups in the same, in similar areas, and definitely there is a lot of optimism, but that optimism should be based on tangible revenues and profits growing in the future.
Okay, Shyam, so let me rephrase my question. Within the listed space, where is it that you find early stage opportunities in a market like this?
No, this is a mature market, so you know, to say, to look at early stage opportunities in this market, I don't find too many early stage opportunities in this market. I think the market is fairly mature, because there's intense competition among investment ideators for opportunities. So I think that most of the ideas have got taken. So I would think that one should keep looking at businesses and just wait for the valuations to come into a zone in which we feel comfortable to invest. And so it's a kind of a waiting watch that is what I'm doing now. I don't really find too many opportunities where I would rush. One potential space where these opportunities could come into play is in the logistics space, especially in the food chain. I think there you could see a lot of opportunities come up. That is one area which I am closely looking at. But I don't find any investments that are really screaming at me to take a significant position in my portfolio.
Okay, so food supply, logistic companies could be an interesting area to look at as well. And excuse me, Shyam, I mean, I didn't mean to ask you about whether an early stage idea would exist. Maybe a couple of themes that could be there. Let me ask you at least one final question from my end, and that is whether you believe infrastructure stroke real estate are at the start of yet another cycle. It's a mature market, well-discovered businesses, but have been through terrible times. Are they restarting a cycle of sorts? And would that be a pocket that you would actively look at in the event of a correction?
Infrastructure, definitely yes. Real estate, definitely no. Infrastructure, yes. I think infrastructure will see a lot of opportunities coming up our way, but real estate, definitely not. Now, directly, I would not play real estate. Maybe through some derived themes, I do own stocks which are connected to the real estate space, in the building materials area and all that. But I would not buy a real estate company because we are not even done 1 year of RERA. So I think just like what happened in the stock market in 94, I expect a prolonged period of uncertainty and customization. The market has to factor in RERA into its business practices and into pricing, and into demand supply. So all this is going to take time. So I would not be positive on real estate, but infrastructure, I would definitely want to play it through parts of the value chain which I find interesting. I would definitely.
So what do you find interesting? Would it be EPC or would it be the other aspects? I mean, what within infrastructure works for you?
No, one way of playing infrastructure is through materials, consumables. So I would probably try to do it through, what today people call as fast-moving industrial goods, you know, the consumables. That is one space which I like. The valuations look a little high. I think if they come down, I would definitely like to buy some consumable companies. That would be my way of playing infrastructure. Another thing would be post this resolution of some of these large steel NPAs, I would definitely want to have at least one investment of significance in steel. That is another way of playing the infrastructure. So I would play it through materials, basically. I would not play it through people who implement these projects, because I think that infrastructure is a capital-hungry business, and I would rather play it through businesses which are able to generate reasonable cash.
Okay. Lastly, Shyam, a couple of these unorganized to organized movement businesses off late have caught fire, especially the dairy space, which is on a roll like none other that I've seen in the recent past. Anything that you believe is on the beneficial side? I would presume building materials is one, the unorganized to organized play, but anything else, dairy or GST-led beneficiaries, if any?
Now, I have been a dairy investor for over a decade. I would like to sound a word of extreme caution on dairy.
Sorry,
it's not an easy business.
You're sounding a word of extreme caution on dairy?
Yes.
Why so? I mean, all managements that we speak to.
I think that we are oversimplifying things. It's a very low margin business. There are a lot of variables. Parts of the value chain, like milk powder, is not going to do well. And I think the farmer, there is a lot of farm stress at the prices of milk cannot be where they are today. So I think that we are essentially oversimplifying investment in dairy. And so I would be cautious, and my investment stance on dairy has changed. I want to record that in this conversation.
Okay, Shyam, we'll leave it at that. Thanks so much for taking the time out and joining us and giving us that perspective. That's Shyam Sekhar of iThought with his thoughts. Remember, I mean, interesting. He's saying that he's a very old investor in dairy companies, and he believes that you should take it with a pinch of salt. It may not necessarily turn out to be the best trade. So do watch out for that as well.